Now that the patient's been optimally managed medically, we have to consider surgical management. And what we are dealing with here is the dressing of a mass lesion. And we'll talk about the various hematomas that we can address surgically. First of all, you have to always think about the existence of a mass lesion under certain clinical certain clinical indications that a mass lesion might exist. And anyone with an altered mental state, you should consider that. People with pupillary abnormalities, usually unilateral pupil dilatation, or let's call it pupil asymmetry, and then lastly people with abnormal flexion or extension or motor posturing, these will be gross clinical signs that there is a mass lesion. So what do we actually have to consider? There's a lot of things that need to be considered before deciding on surgical management of the patient. And we really have to consider the Glasgow Coma Scale score, for instance, the mentioned pupillary reflexes, pupillary state and pupillary reflexes, any comorbidities, patients with multiple, not only the trauma but also pre-existing comorbidities. We have to look, consider the CT scan findings that we get. We have to consider the age of the patient, and we also have to consider intracranial pressure monitoring. We've discussed a lot about intracranial pressure monitoring, and when those are inserted, you have to consider this as well. But probably most importantly is the neurological change over time. If there's a deterioration, of the neurological state of the patient. So all things that have to be considered. There's certainly no easy algorithm to decide whether a patient should get evacuation of intracranial mass lesion. In the next video, we'll start looking at the various lesions. So the first mass lesion we'll discuss is the epidural hematoma, that is between the cranium and the dura. We're talking of incidence of all traumatic brain injuries of the order of only about 3% of all patients with traumatic brain injury will harbor an extradural hematoma. And if you only consider those patients that are comatose, that might go up to about 9 or 10%. This is usually in the age group 20 to 30 years of age, and there's, as with all of these, there is a male predominance. What is the actual pathology? Well, that's usually injury to the middle meningeal artery. With an overlying parietal skull fracture. Let's put that parietal skull fracture, because that's indeed where this artery runs. But you can also get middle meningeal vein arteries, middle meningeal vein injuries, the diploic veins, and also the venous sinuses in that area. That can lead to an extradural hematoma. But most commonly it's the middle meningeal artery with an overlying parietal skull fracture. What is the clinical picture of these? Well, about one half to one third of these patients will be comatose. So let's say half to a third of them are actually comatose when they come in. And what's important about these is half of these patients with extradural hematoma will have this, what is called the lucid period type of picture, where they have initial loss of consciousness, wake up and have this lucid period, and then actually have their neurological state deteriorate. So up to half of patients will undergo this typical clinical picture. So who do we operate and who do we not operate? We are looking at the size of the clot, the volume of the clot, and whether there's any midline shifts. Now, so if we just want to list specifically the indications for non-operative management of these patients, we really do want them to have a clot thickness of less than 15 millimeters clot thickness. Let's put that, clot thickness. Or the volume of it, if we just look at the volume of less than 30 milliliters. Less than 30 milliliters, and if there is a bit of midline shift, it's got to be less than 5 millimeters midline shift. Now, all of these patients, this has to be non-comatose patients, and they also have to have no focal neurological signs. No focal signs. They have no focal signs, they're non-comatose, they have these sort of parameters on their CT scan. They are candidates for non-operative management. Non-operative management means they need to be admitted and they need to have neurological examination on a regular basis and have follow-up CT scans as per indication as well. The ones that usually do well, or this kind of patients, usually ones with bleeding overlying the temporal lobe. The temporal lobe are usually the ones in this sort of category. Now, patients that should undergo surgical management, surgical evacuation, are those with the severe traumatic brain injury. So we're talking Glasgow Coma Scale. Glasgow Coma Scale of 3 to 8 should be considered. Patients with a volume of 30 mils plus, 30 milliliters plus volume of the extradural hematoma should be considered for immediate surgical evacuation. And this is irrespective of whether they have focal signs or whether they're comatose. All patients with this size of an epidural hematoma must be considered for immediate evacuation. There is a definite decrease or worsening of the outcome in a delay between the incident and surgery when we are dealing with these kinds of patients. You can also add to this list then the reverse of this. This one is most important. Any patient, irrespective of this, should have that. But in a comatose patient then, which is indeed this patient, usually will have a clot thickness of more than that or a midline shift more than that. But most importantly is this is irrespective of whether they are comatose or have focal neurological signs.